house fire is over. Heavenly Father, we're grateful today that the praise report has gone forward. Yet we believe by faith today, individually and collectively, that there indeed is a blessing with our name on it. Father, the only blessing we need today is your word.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
The only thing that can heal us is your word.
That's it. Yes, Lord.
The only thing that can free us is your word.
That's it.
So, Father, as I stand today as a broken vessel, touch these lips of clay, oh God. Take hold of my heart, God, which belongs to you. And according to your word, Father, in the book of Acts, feed the sheep. If somebody needs a word from you today, Lord. And as I stand today, God, I stand by faith, believing that today, even now, there is a balm in Gilead. So, Master, as I decrease, and as your spirit has already increased, Father, as I cling to the cross, and as I hide therein, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable only in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the people of God say amen. Amen.
Amen
and amen. Come on, give God a praise up here. Come on, give God a praise up here. Come on, give God a praise up here. Come on, come on, praise up here. Today, turn back. Thank you for the scripture reading. Turn back to the scripture that was read for your hearing this afternoon. Season are also hungry during the Christmas season. So I want to charge us today. So the purpose of my show today is to charge us. Let me caveat what I'm going to say, and I want to echo thank you for Deacon LeGrand. I want to thank Deacon LeGrand personally and to the board, to all of you on behalf of my wife and family for your generosity. My heart is very joyous today, and I'm so grateful today. And I don't want to belittle that joy. I'm so grateful for your kindness and the gift that you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for Evangelist Daniel reminding me. She whispered to me across the pulpit that God will give you the desires of your heart.
Amen.
And so thank you for reminding me of that. Come on, give God a hand. If you all, but for a few moments, if you all will, I want you to take your time and digest what the Spirit of the Lord is going to say to us today. A very serious mother, on a very serious matter, Sister Iwoda, because we have a responsibility. We are the Church of the Living God. I said, we are the Church of the Living God. And we have an awesome responsibility in this community. So if you all would pray with me and pray for me for a teaching thought today, and I want to see pencils and I want to see paper and I want you writing, because as you receive scriptures, amen, I want you to go home and I want you to check my math. Don't just take my word for it. Go home and check my math to make sure that I'm adding the numbers up right. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
For a moment this afternoon, I want to use for a teaching thought the question. Turn to somebody and look at them. You're going to ask them a question. Look at them and say, beloved. Come on, look at somebody and say, beloved.
Am I
my brother's keeper?
My brother's keeper.
Look at somebody else. Look at somebody else and say, beloved.
Am I
my brother's keeper?
My brother's keeper.
I'm going to use for teaching a thought today to be reassured, and I want us to consider individually and collectively, Elder, our response to the question, am I my brother's keeper? In our nation today, I'm going to start by giving you some very real statistics. In our nation today, it is documented that there is well over 636,000 people nationally who are counted as homeless. Over 636,000 people who are counted as homeless. And with all the data, I'm going to share some data with you. This is actual data. I did some research and I pulled this data from the National Alliance to End Homelessness. For anyone who does not know or who even might care, it is about 8 years ago now. I'm grateful to God that the Lord allowed me to be commissioned as part of a team of people. There were 20 of us who were commissioned to put together a strategic plan for the city of Tacoma. And we spent about a year and a half studying the issue of homelessness, and we put together a 10-year plan called Road Home, and the intent of that plan was to end homelessness. Somebody else say amen.
Amen.
And so this issue is very near and dear, Brother Larry, thought to my heart, and it's a very real issue. Because the reality, and let me just put an asterisk here, because here's the reality that we don't deal with. Right sitting next to you, your right or your left or in front of you or behind you, is somebody who might be on the verge of homelessness. You understand that, maybe, baby? That's how serious this issue is. We don't realize how right in our midst that there are people who are sometimes living from paycheck to paycheck. Folks who, amen, who are blessed by the grace and the mercy of God. Somebody talk back to me today. And so I want us to take the voice of God very seriously. As I was studying this information, I was reminded, Brother Larry, of the account of the feeding of the multitude that said that there were 5,000, not including men and women. I mean, including women and children. And when we consider the fact that these numbers have been accounted, and certainly the numbers are factual, Sister Penny, but I believe that there's so many who were not counted. Are you getting the gist of what I'm saying? So I'm not saying the data is not accurate. What I'm saying is that the numbers are not completely accurate because you never can capture the truth about the poverty of America. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
21 homeless people per 10,000 people. Watch this number, startling. 31 homeless veterans per 10,000 veterans. How is it possible that they can give their life for the country and come home and not be respected and cared for? How is it possible that veterans can walk through the alleyways and the only result of accepting the fact that they've been mistreated by their company is to drink or to drug themselves away from the reality that they've been rejected by the very country that they gave their life for? Are you all praying with me? Nearly 4 in 10 were unsheltered, living in the streets or in cars, abandoned buildings, or other places not intended for human habitation. The unsheltered population increased by 2%, from 239,000+ to somewhere resonating around 243,000. The number of individuals in homeless families decreased by 1% nationally, but increased by 20% in more than 11 states. So even though the national number has declined year over year, there are many states where that's not the case. While the homeless population decreased nationally, it has increased in 24 states, including the District of Columbia. Homelessness is basically caused by the inability of people to pay for housing. Thus, it is impacted by both income and affordable and available housing. The number of poor households that spent more than 50% of their income on rent, defined by HUD as households that are severely housing cost burdened. These are people who they have income, but more than 50% of the income goes to keep a roof over their head. Am I talking to anybody? Anybody receiving this today? Increased by 6%. The number of unemployed people increased by 4%. And then lastly, this is no surprise, foreclosure activity continued to increase with nearly 50,000 more homes in foreclosure today. In the book of Mark, write, in the book of Mark in the 14th chapter, 7a, Jesus himself said, "For ye have the poor with you always." Even though I participated in that exercise, Mother Audrey, I've come to now accept and realize that God cannot lie. That though we desire to see homelessness go away, though we desire to see people have a roof over their head, though we desire to see people not take their life as a response to the plight in their life, the reality is homelessness is not going to go away. Somebody talk back to me. But we cannot accept that, Sister Marcia, as the answer. We still, Christ said, we still have a job to do. Am I talking to anyone? Even though we're not going to be able to stop people, Brother Larry, from being homeless, we still have a job to do. Though we're not going to feed every person, every child, every man, every woman, we still have a responsibility. Church of the Living God has an assignment in this city that we must be executing, and we must execute it with excellence. Amen. Somebody say excellence.
Excellence.
Write it down. Proverbs 11:25. Proverbs 11:25 says, the liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall be watered also himself. See, the word of God says that the level of our generosity will bestow the level of blessing upon the house of the church of living God. If we are tight-fisted, then we will choke the life out of the dollars that God has entrusted us with. I'm going someplace. If we're misers, actually, and we're always constantly counting every penny, how many of us know you can't count God's blessings? Somebody get that next week. You can't count God's blessings. But if our focus is counting what we have, then our focus is not on what God has for us. Turn to somebody and tell them, don't limit God. The word of God, the wise man, the recorder Solomon in Proverbs said that if we will bestow God's blessings on others, then God is faithful. Turn to somebody and tell them, God will bless you back. Write it down. Solomon went on in the 14th chapter, verse number 21. Write it down. Proverbs 14 and 21. I'm not going to be long, but I want you to study these. Proverbs 14, 21 says these words. It said, he that despises his neighbor sinneth. But he that hath mercy on the poor, happy is he. See, it ought to make us feel good when God blesses us to be able to reach out to someone else. It ought to make you feel good in order to give somebody support, give somebody aid. It ought to give you joy. See, we ought not do what we do begrudgingly. We ought not do what we do with a lack of faith, but it ought to make us happy. Sister Gray, anytime we can bless somebody else, I think about the work that we do. When we give food away, we ought to give food away with a smile on our face. When somebody comes in and needs gold and says, I need a pair of shoes, or I need a pair of pants, or I need a coat or blanket to keep myself warm, we ought to run up the stairs and we ought to be happy to give somebody something that's in need. Talk back to me. Because we ought to consider where God brought us from. Anybody ever been on the verge? Ain't no shame in the house of God. Because all of us have been there at one time or another.
Right.
Where God had you in a place where you had that almost faith. Almost can pay your house note. Almost can pay your car note. Almost had enough to buy groceries. Talk back to me, somebody. If this is relevant to you, don't worry about what nobody else is responding. This is you and God. Anybody ever been in that position where you didn't know where it was coming from and then out of nowhere it showed up? You didn't know how it was going to work out, but somebody walked by and just pressed something in your hand. And folks don't think that I listen, but I've heard the testimonies, even not public testimony. I'm talking about conversations here or there where somebody talked about the fact that they were at a gas pump and somebody walked up and just put gas in. Am I talking to anybody? Or you were in the grocery line and you had to put something back and said, I got that. Anybody ever been there? And God expects us to always remember, always be reminded where we came from. All of us have been helped, Brother Daniels, from one time or another. And I believe that God has helped us so that we can have evidence of the fact that God helps those who will help others. Am I talking to anybody? Proverbs 14 to 31. I'm going someplace. Proverbs 14 to 31 says these words. He that oppresses the poor reproaches his maker. But he that honoreth him hath mercy on the poor. Again,
Solomon telling us that when we bless somebody who's in need, we're just honoring God. Original text tells us, I'll get there, original text tells us, when you've done it to the least of these, my brother, you've done it unto me. Don't you know that when you bless somebody, you're blessing God? Don't you know that when you help somebody, you're helping God? We are his hands, we are his eyes, we are his mouth, we are the tangible Christ that people will see from day to day. Don't you, and I'm not talking about every situation, don't always take a knee-jerk reaction and start emptying out your pocket. Yeah. Am I talking to anybody? Yeah. What was that word to you? Wisdom. Wisdom comes from the Spirit of God. When you're led by the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God will tell you when to give and when not to give. All
right.
I can tell the story because it belongs to me. I remember coming to church service, and this is back in the day, Brother Dave, you know how we used to trade off. And one Sunday you'll get the sausage and we'll cut it up for Sunday school. Next Sunday I get it. And they don't know nothing about that. We cut it up for Sunday school. And so it was my turn to get the sausage. And I stopped by Sars over there by the house. And so we pulled up. And when we pulled up in the car, Deacon thought there was a homeless man that was sitting against the building. So I can tell my story, sitting against the building, and I can remember as clearly as it is right now that my son, Matthew, I had given the boys a dollar, Deacon LeGrand, for their Sunday school offering. And I pulled up, and Matthew said, Dad, can I give that man my dollar? I said, no, son, no. I said, please, Dad, please. I said, no, it's all right, it's okay. And he said, Dad, no, please, can I get it? And it pierced my heart.
Yes.
See, none of us are exempt from having your heart pierced.
All right.
Now, I'm on my way supposedly to do the work of God.
Yes.
I'm on my way to preach the word of God. Listen, you don't know what you did when you agreed with me when you talked about that heart this morning. See, it's a heart. How is your heart today? See, there's no way that my heart can be cold when the Spirit of God is speaking to me and showing me clearly that there's need. Now watch this. Homelessness and brokenness, tragedy does not always look tore up on the floor. I'm trying to help somebody.
That's right.
See, because we have a warped vision of what help looks like. We think that help is dirty, that we think help is dysfunctional. Don't you know that somebody sitting right next to you right now needs some help?
No, I'm going to teach this thing today.
I want to make sure they hear something. This word needs to get deep down inside of us. Because we're the church of the living God. We're going to be who God say we are. Because see, somebody sitting right next to you is in need right now. And the spirit of pride has them bound. The spirit of shame has them bound. But I'm coming to raise war today.
That's it.
I'm coming to raise war against pride. Against shame, against embarrassment, and all this other devil. It's a lying spirit.
Yes.
You don't have to be ashamed in the house of God. You'll never have to be embarrassed amongst your friends. We're family.
Yes.
And it's a shame before God that people will not come to, I said this Friday night, for those of you who are there, we think that just because we open the doors on Sunday morning that folks gonna run into the house of God. We fooling ourselves. It's going to take us going to meet the need.
That's right.
Folks ain't going to come to the house of God. They ain't going to call the house of God and tell them simply what they need. Not the majority of not. Because they think that the church is going to hold their nose up and they're going to look funny at it.
You don't hear it anyway.
Proverbs 19 to 17, write it down. Proverbs 19 to 17 said, he that hath pity upon the poor lendeth unto the Lord. And that which he hath given, he will repay him again.
Ain't that a trick? You mean I can kick God out?
Or did I misread that? Look at the Bible. He that hath pity upon the Lord lendeth to the Lord. Don't you know that God can take your little bit? If you don't believe me, ask the boy that had two fish.
Somebody should have ran through the aisles right there.
See, the devil's trying to convince you that your little bit don't mean nothing in the house of God. You better want to keep that. You better hold on to. Listen, you can't afford not to pay. You can't afford not to pay God. Because even though you don't have everything that you want, you better be grateful for what you got. Am I talking to anybody here today? See, even those who are needy can help somebody else, Bobby. Even those who are distressed can help somebody else. Because the reality is that somebody's worse off than you are. Anybody going to receive this word today? The reality is somebody's in a worse position than you are. And so don't let the devil make you cheat God. Turn to somebody and tell them, don't cheat God. Because the reality is you can't be God's gift. I dare you to try. I dare you to try and bless somebody and see when God bless you right back. I dare you to try and help somebody see if